Sir, a 30-year-old gentleman presented with right-sided deviation of face in stew days.
So
So
what more information you want in this case?
I would also like to ask about any associated weakness of limbs.
Here it doesn't have.
Okay, then any recent history of any infections,
Like
like viral infections.
what viral infection you are suspecting?
I mean, herpes zoster.
Herpes zoster. What's the usual age group of people suffering the herpes zoster?
Herpes zoster usually comes late in the adulthood.
Herpes zoster disease of the old people
Old people.
after age of 60 years. Chickenpox come early.
Okay, on chickenpox.
Whenever herpes zoster comes in young age, think about immunocompromised states, diabetic, on steroids, on methotrexate, anti-cancer drugs, somebody is on dialysis, somebody is not well, otherwise people don't get it. Multiple myeloma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, such scenarios you get retrovirus infections, you can get immune suppression, and then young people with herpes zoster. Yes, but anything else about the history, other viral disease?
Any recent history of any surgery, sir?
Okay, what else you want?
Then
What surgery you're suspecting?
something related to parotid.
Parotid surgery, very good. Okay, what else you want?
Then any recent history of any ear infection?
No ear infection, anything else?
Then any recent history of trauma?
No osteotrauma.
History of trauma. Then.
Okay, in the past history, there was a suspicion that he was a diabetic but now well controlled on diet treatment. No relevant family history. Okay, we move forward. So, can you make a diagnosis at this time?
Not definitely, sir. I can say a differential diagnosis.
Yes, you tell.
Sir, diabetes mellitus can cause Bell's palsy,
Okay, fine.
we don't know if it is UMN or LMN. So,
Okay, you want to go for further evaluation. So, how do you want to analyze the history? You said you want to know LMN or UMN, so what did you do?
first of all, if it is UMN, if it is a stroke, there will be associated weakness, so I have
That's
to
good.
assess that.
That's good.
Then, so it's unilateral, so brainstem issues can be, that can be ruled out.
How will you analyze it? What symptom, what history you'll get for brainstem? Where is the nucleus of seventh nerve situated?
Pons, sir.
Pons. So, if the pons is affected, what are the things you get?
Then also abducens nerve.
So, what symptom they will have?
Then I mean then
What
there
symptom they will have?
ophthalmoplegia, ophthalmoplegia.
What symptom they will have?
There diplopia.
Diplopia. Okay. So, you have to find out from the history whether he can close the eyes. If he cannot close the eyes at all, that is LMN lesion. You would like to know whether it's insidious, acute, or chronic. Associated things you already said, diplopia, hemiplegia. Suppose there is history of ascending paralysis, what will you make out?
GBS.
GBS, yes. So you want to know the history of muscle weakness of other muscles, sensory loss, emotional changes. If there's vertigo and hearing loss, what will you suggest?
Costing again.
Okay. Involvement of taste, how does it help you?
Sir, we can localize the lesion because it's
Taste.
coming from caudal tympani, so.
Okay. So, history of fever, vesicular lesion you already mentioned about herpes zoster. Suppose there's a cardiac involvement, like a heart block. Then we'll think about Lyme disease. History of discharge, you said otitis media. How does otitis media produce seventh nerve paralysis?
Otitis media can affect the mastoid segment, sir, of facial nerve.
Facial nerve. How does trauma affect the facial nerve?
If it is okay, it can damage the branches lying below the parotid or
After parotid or even inside the
after parotid.
cranium, if the fracture of the petrous bone, you can have a problem. what toxin you are suspecting?
Botulinum. Botulinum.
How does botulism present?
Produces is a bilateral.
Bilateral ophthalmoplegia. Past history, diabetes you already said, tumor and surgery you already mentioned, drug history, examination. Yes.
Okay, so
what do you want to do in the general examination?
General examination, if we have to check if the patient is conscious and oriented.
Yes, very good. He's okay. Coming to cranial nerves, what will you look for?
Cranial nerve, first we have to we can look for the facial muscles and sensations in the anterior two thirds of the tongue.
So the findings are given here. No wrinkling of forehead on left side. What does it mean?
Oh, so it means left side there is a element.
Yes, eye closure is absent, mouth is deep at right side. Other systems are within normal limits. So general examination, specifically what all things you are looking for?
So patient's vitals?
No, our idea is to find out the etiology.
Etiology. So we have to look skin lesions. Sir.
What skin lesion? Be specific.
Sir, vesicles.
Where do you look for vesicles?
In one side of the in face or trunk.
Which part of the face you are looking for? Ophthalmic division, maxillary division, or mandibular division. Where do you look for?
Ophthalmic division.
So this herpes infection you are looking for in the ear. And sometimes the palate, not on the face. What else you are looking for? Ear discharge.
Discharge.
You're looking for a scar of mastoidectomy. You look for any tumor of the parotid. Any cuts or wounds on the face. What else you look for? You look for signs of leprosy. Right? Can leprosy produce facial palsy?
Yes.
You look for tick bite. Which condition produces skin lesion and facial palsy? Lyme disease. So you need to look around for reason for the facial palsy. That's what focused general examination. Be very specific when you get a short case. Specific. These things are absent. Okay. What else you want to look for?
Then in general examination.
You want to look for the cranial nerves. Which are cranial nerves you are focusing on?
Facial, then abducens.
Abducens, you already mentioned, is in close proximity in the pons. So they go together. Yes. Any other cranial nerve is of interest to you?
Eighth nerve, sir, in acoustic neuroma.
Yes. Any other nerve you are interested? You are looking for fifth nerve. Why?
It can be affected in herpes zoster, sir.
Fifth nerve is commonly going with seventh nerve in the CP angle. So that can be along with the eighth nerve. Motor system, how do you differentiate LMN from UMN?
We can look for UMN will be spastic, facial muscles will be.
How will you demonstrate spasticity of facial muscles? No, UMN and LMN is differentiated by the distribution. LMN facial paralysis, whole face will be paralyzed. And UMN, only the lower part will be dominantly paralyzed. Upper part, if at all, minimal. That's how differentiate between the two. And presence of bell sign indicates that eye cannot be closed and confirms that it is a LMN facial palsy. Sensory system, what are you focusing on?
So, leprosy and diabetes mellitus, we can have peripheral neuropathy.
What is the type of peripheral neuropathy in leprosy? Tell me something about that.
Bone type can produce small fiber.
Leprosy produces asymmetrical paralysis of different nerves. It is not like a symmetrical paralysis of diabetes mellitus. Then specifically coming to the seventh nerve, what are you looking for?
she must test it if
You have
it is
to look for specifically for localization. What all things you look for?
So she must test. It means that I mean the parasympathetic fibers for if the salivation is gone, that means correlative. It is at the level of correlative binding.
Okay, that's agreed.
Okay, then
yes.
Schirmer test means it is at the level of what is it there? Great.
Superficial petrosal nerve.
Great superficial petrosal nerve. Great superficial petrosal nerve is involved if its lacrimation is gone. These are the two parasympathetic fibers.
Then
there is if the stapedius muscle is involved, the patient can have hyperacusis.
How will you demonstrate it?
That is why
patient will have unpleasant loudness of sounds in that particular ear. Unpleasant loudness. So even tuning for they may not tolerate. Okay. Anything else you want to look for? The localization.
It also has a posterior auricular branch, so we can look at the sensations in the
minimal. Okay. You want to check the a motor system. Anything else?
Sir, cerebellar system.
Why?
Sir, it is the facial nerve is coming at the cerebellar angle. So if there is
okay. Any, so you are looking for the localization. Tell me about the composition of facial nerve.
Facial
what type of nerve is that?
It has motor, it has sensory, it also has autonomic components.
It has got parasympathetic going for lacrimal and salivary glands. It has got afferent from taste sensation is there, no? In addition to sensation and motor you already mentioned. So four components are there for facial nerve. So where does it start from?
Starts from the pons, sir.
Pons, then what happens? What's the relationship? What's the relationship with abducens nerve?
It rounds around, forming facial colliculus.
Yes, it forms a facial colliculus and comes out. Then what happens?
Then it enters the internal acoustic meatus.
Yes, with whom? Who are the friends? What is the relationship at that time?
With the fifth nerve.
Fifth nerve and eighth nerve go together in the CP angle, and this enters the internal acoustic foramen. Then what does it do?
Then it comes and it enters the middle ear.
Okay, then.
Okay, then it then there is the vertical segment that is in the mastoid.
Okay.
Then it comes to the stylo mastoid foramen. And
so where is the ganglion situated? What's that ganglion called?
Genicular ganglion.
Why it's called geniculate?
Because that is where there is the genu of the facial nerve. I mean, it takes a turn.
So this is, it's a bend.
That's a bend.
It's a bend. So the ganglion situated the bend. So it goes to the genicular ganglion, and from there, which fiber goes, which branch goes off from there?
Great, superficial petrosal.
Petrosal nerve. Okay, then it comes down. Then what happens?
Then there is the labyrinthine branch.
Okay, then what else?
Then from there, it gives the nerve to stapedius.
Stapedius goes. Okay, then.
Then it comes down and it comes to before. Coming out from the stylo mastoid foramen gives correlative binding.
So we have got three important branches there, which will be helpful for diagnosis. So at level of the pons, CP angle, at the level of the ganglion, and then before it gives to stapedius, and before it goes to correlative binding. So you can easily localize. And then comes out the stylo mastoid foramen, then?
Yeah, then it gives the facial branches.
Five
branches under the carotid.
So each branch can be separately paralyzed. It will not be nerve as such, depending upon the site of injury. Okay. So you can see the three are going together. Eighth nerve, fifth nerve, and nerve intermedius all go together. then you got genicular ganglion from which you got these branches, and accordingly you can easily localize. Simple. You already mentioned it. And tell me something more about the nucleus. Why you said the LMN produces complete weakness of the face, and UMN produces only one side weakness?
I mean, it is bilateral representation. The upper part of the face has bilateral representation in the cortex.
So that's what you see in the green here. It gets a representation from both sides. So if one side is paralyzed, you get only minimal weakness, 50% weakness. But if it is a LMN paralysis, there's only one root. So you get
complete
paralysis. So there is something called emotional pathway. It has got third, it's a separate pathway, not with the UMN, not with the, it goes to the nucleus from there. In the nerve, both volitional and emotional fibers are going together. So when you have a LMN facial palsy, the emotion is affected. How will you test the emotion fibers? If I had to test Gautam, emotional fibers, what can I do?
So we ask the patient to laugh.
So if you ask the patient to laugh, it is volitional. So emotional pathway is always spontaneous. So how do you induce spontaneous smile? You have to crack a joke. Okay. So what's commonly done is I ask Gautam to whistle to a female bystander there. Obviously, you will become a bit shy and you just smile spontaneously. I can see how your face goes. Okay. So testing for emotional pathway is important because emotional pathway helps us. It's affected. It's a bilateral. Sorry, it's a LMN lesion because pathway for volitional and emotional go in the LMN. UMN is separate pathway. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Now, emotional pathway is going separate pathway. Some people, that pathway get involved. So, there will not be any facial paralysis. But when they smile, they will have deviation of the face. So, that's called emotional paralysis. Okay. So, supranuclear, how do you localize? Human facial palsy. So, whenever there is a human paralysis, you usually expect there should be Hemiparesis, no? Emotional paralysis and volitional paralysis are different terms. Okay. Now, nuclear and fascicular lesion, how do you diagnose? Nuclear, you already mentioned, there will be associated sixth nerve paralysis. Because it's winding around, they go together usually. They cannot go alone. Okay. So both abducens nerve and sixth nerve may be affected. And there are some syndromes in relation to the pons. What are the syndrome? Millard-Gubler syndrome, what is it? Same, 7th plus 6th on the same side, and opposite side there will be
weakness.
So that's called crossed hemiplegia. So localization in the pons. Okay. So, we have foveal syndrome. What does it do? Here, in addition to the facial nerve and the corticospinal tract, it affects the parapondine
reticular fibers.
Reticular formation. So, what will you get?
The lateral gaze.
Paralysis will be there, contralateral hemiplegia, and same size will be facial nerve. Again, another type of cross syndrome. Cross hemiplegia, where the gaze palsy is also there. So what is 8.5 syndrome? 7 is 7th nerve. 8.5 means you must get 1.5 more. Yes?
8th nerve, 6th nerve, and facial nerve.
So this is a situation where you find internuclear ophthalmoplegia is taking place. What is internuclear ophthalmoplegia?
I mean, the external muscles are not involved. Only the external extraorbital muscles are not involved. Only the
You're right. These movements, 3, 4, 6 nerves, move the eyeball like a yoke. The yoke movement, that means when your left eye is moving laterally, right eye is medially parallel. Eye movement is parallel. And this is done with the help of what's called median longitudinal fasciculus. When this is affected, you get a situation where you call it as internuclear ophthalmoplegia. Internuclear, that means the connecting fibers between the two nucleus through medial longitudinal fasciculus is affected. So they'll have horizontal gaze palsy and seventh nerve palsy also. But half of the movement will be retained. So it is not 9 syndrome, but 8.5. 7 plus 1.5. Okay. So this is called 8.5 syndrome. These syndromes are essential for examination purpose. You don't see it on daily basis. In the posterior fossa lesions, you know, posterior fossa, you got CP angle.
CP angles.
So all diseases affecting the cholesteatoma, acoustic neuroma, meningioma can produce problems. And of course, you are looking at the accompanying signs, relationship of the nerve and reason. Meatal lesion, how do you diagnose?
Meatal lesion, it will be LMN lesion, but there are no branches.
So what happens is, before it is giving off branches, so all the branches will be affected. Lacrimation, taste, everything will be affected. Okay. Now, within the facial canal, distal to the meatal segment, proximal to the departure of terminus stapedius. You get classical hyperacusis and?
Then lacrimation is also.
So, all the nerves branches are affected according to the anatomical localization. And between the terminus stapedius and caudate tympani?
Salivation. The sensations that the anterior tooth of the tongue will be gone.
How will you test the sensation of the tongue?
We can use that sugar solution.
What do you do with the solution?
We can put a drop in the anterior tooth. And
when you put a drop on the one side of the tongue, it will automatically spill to the opposite side. So what did you do? You take a swab, dip in the solution and rub it on the surface of the one side of the tongue, holding the tongue such a way that tongue does not go in and patient does not close the mouth. Okay, that's how it is done. So in this position, you'll have LMN facial palsy, taste involvement. Why they don't have hyperacusis?
Because stapedius has already come, it's
already gone. Yes, so this course of the facial nerve and the branches are important to make the anatomical localization. Anatomical localization tells you the etiological diagnosis. That's why you should diagnose it. Distal to the caudate tympani, what can happen?
Distal to the caudate tympani, so all the parasympathetic fibers are spared. So the salivation and lacrimation will be normal. Only the facial muscles will be
affected. Okay. So before the stylomaxillary foramen or with the stylomaxillary foramen, it goes like that. Then no taste involvement, no hyperacusis. Distal to stylomaxillary foramen, what all things can happen?
Distal to stylomaxillary foramen, the individual muscles can be involved.
That depends upon what type of surgery is done, what type of trauma has occurred, whether it's idiopathic palsy at the level of the stylomaxillary foramen. Okay. With Hansen's disease, only branches are expected to be gone. Yes. Idiopathic facial palsy, or Bell's palsy affects all the branches. So what are the etiologies of bilateral UMN, bilateral LMN, unilateral LMN, and unilateral and bilateral emotional paralysis?
Bilateral LMN, bilateral LMN can be seen in syringobulbia.
First question, bilateral UMN. UMN means what?
UMN means it's above the pons.
No, wonderful form.
Upper motor neuron disease.
So upper motor neuron produces what are the conditions producing upper motor neuron diseases?
Sir.
Medical words.
Strokes, sir.
Strokes. So bilateral strokes. Called cerebellar palsy. Anything else? So, bilateral UMN, pseudobulbar palsy, commonest we encounter is vascular accidents, demyelinating lesions, multiple sclerosis, motor neuron disease, tumors, relatively rare for us. For us, pseudobulbar palsy should be top on the list. Bilateral LMN?
Bilateral LMN?
What is meant by LMN?
Lower motor neuron.
What does it mean? So what other things are included here?
From the nucleus.
So one is nucleus. One is nucleus. Two.
Two is
nerve. Then trace it down. What happens next?
Then the the neuromuscular junction.
Neuromuscular junction. Then muscle. So tell me differential diagnosis, different levels.
So if it is the brainstem, it can be. Something involving both the nucleus.
Yes, brainstem can involve both nucleus. Yes, pontine hemorrhage, cerebellar palsy. Yes, pontine tumors can produce. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Then
the nerve bilateral element.
Classically occur in diabetic patients. Classically occur in Guillain-Barré syndrome. Classically occur in patients with sarcoidosis. That is possible. Yes. Any other? What neuromuscular junction? Muscle?
Neuromuscular junction, sir. Myasthenia gravis.
Myasthenia gravis can produce same problem. Botulism. Okay. So you have got neuromuscular junction, botulism, organ of source poisoning. Muscle level, what all things can happen?
Myotonic dystrophy.
Myotonic dystrophy. Yes. Anything else?
Sir,
what type of muscular dystrophies affect the facial muscles? Facio, scapulo, humeral myopathy. Can you name some other types of myopathies? Duchenne. Duchenne, variant, Becker's. Then facio, scapulo, humeral. Limb girdle, muscular dystrophy. Another type of muscle disease, congenital myopathy, where also you can have facial palsy. Yes. Okay. Peripheral nerves bilaterally.
Diabetes and leprosy.
GBS, leprosy, diabetes, GBS. Lyme disease, sarcoidosis. So many things. Unilateral element possibilities are?
Bell's palsy.
Bell's palsy. What is Bell's palsy?
Because it shows Bell's phenomenon.
Well, what do you mean by Bell's palsy? Commonly, it is applied for idiopathic. Okay. Unilateral can occur in pontine lesions, CP angle lesions, petrous epidermoid tumors, infections, surgeries in middle ear, trauma to petrous bone, tumors of the parotid, or surgery for parotid. Okay. But unilateral emotional paralysis, thalamic lesion, thalamo-frontal connections, bilateral emotional paralysis. Parkinsonism, pseudobulbar palsy. Now tell me what are the components of pseudobulbar palsy? What are the common symptoms of pseudobulbar palsy?
Pseudobulbar palsy.
They come with the dysarthria. They come with the dysphagia. And they come with emotional incontinence. Now, what are the signs related to pseudobulbar palsy?
Sir, the Georgia.
So where is the lesion diagnosis localization in the pseudobulbar palsy?
Sir, it is above the pons. It's UMN, bilateral UMN.
Bilateral UMN above the pons. So bilateral UMN can produce problems. Okay. So what are the difference between UMN versus LMN?
So UMN versus LMN. First is the level of involvement. In LMN, only the upper part is.
Okay.
Right. I mean, viewing, okay, the blinking is affected, mouth cannot move with open command.
Okay. What is Bell's phenomenon?
We ask the patient to close the eyes, so his eyeball will move up.
Well, is it normal or abnormal?
It indicates elements.
Element. Okay. So what is the difference between what is meant by Bell's palsy?
It is unilateral element palsy of facial
palsy of idiopathic in nature.
Of idiopathic.
So when somebody comes to you, what is the usual age group of people with Bell's palsy?
Older people. Old. I mean, usually diabetic or patients with.
And what will you do? What investigations you plan? And what will you do?
We can look for this electroneurography.
What is your idea behind investigation? You have to find out the cause for it. So the common things you check for, whether he's retrovirus positive, is a leprosy, is he a diabetic, is he in course of time developing Guillain-Barré syndrome, or features of Lyme disease is there, is there otitis media. If you don't find any cause, then you confirm it is a case of Bell's palsy. How do you treat that patient?
Their response to steroids, sir.
How much heavy dose has to be given? 60 to 80 milligram. You have to give for 5 to 10 days. Course of treatment is given. And do you give anything else?
Nothing else.
Nothing else is given. So JR1 Parvati, please. What else you can give?
Hello, sir.
What else can you give?
The antiviral may be given.
How do you select patients for antiviral treatment?
Immunosuppressed patients.
Antiviral drugs are commonly given for patients who are not likely to recover with steroids. And you can predict that based upon the severity of facial paralysis. And facial paralysis is graded into 4 grades.
Yes, sir.
Grade 4 is the one where there is no movement of the face at all. These groups of patients usually do not recover. It is this group of patients commonly you give valacyclovir 1 gram 8 hourly for 7 days time. Why you are giving for few people, why you are not giving for a few others? Majority of the patients recover, 80% will recover with the steroids.
Okay, sir.
And how long it will take for recovery?
A few months.
How many months you want? You will take at least 6 months for recovery. And full recovery is expected except in the small group. That small group, we are thinking that possibly there is a virus infection and you are giving treatment. Ideally, better to identify the virus and then give treatment. But as of now, there are no techniques to differentiate between viral disease producing this paralysis and idiopathic inflammatory reaction, as in case of idiopathic Bell's palsy. What else can you give in the treatment form? What else can we give? You have to protect his eyes. So eyes cannot be closed. You give them protective glasses during daytime. Nighttime you tape the eye and keep the eye closed to prevent keratitis. Invariably, if the tear secretions are affected, eye will be dry and you will have to give them artificial tears. And they are likely to get more corneal ulcers. So if their eye becomes red, you have to take care of that part and take care of the patient. And in course of time, they will recover. They will recover. Till that time, you have to give them adequate exercises and supportive physiotherapy and moral support. And what are the sequelae you expect in these patients?
there may be residual paralysis of the facial muscles, and there can be conditions like gustatory tearing or gustatory sweating due to faulty innervation.
What is it by synkinesis? Synkinesia.
Again, faulty innervation, that is
involuntary contraction of a part of the
facial nerve, then
some other part is contracting.
So, like closing of the eyes while chewing.
Okay. So, how can you treat this patient, synkinesis? You can leave them alone or try with botulinum toxin.
Okay, sir.
So, one complication is aberrant regeneration producing what is called as motor type of problems, or it can be in relation to regeneration of lacrimal glands such a way that when you are salivating you may have lacrimation. So when you eat food you have lacrimation, it's called as crocodile tears.
Yes.
What's the role of surgery in these patients? Do you go for any surgery for these patients?
Ablation of, if it is severely discomforting the patient, then go for ablation of the nerve.
Ablation of what?
Ablation of the nerve, that is.
So what does it, how does it help you? So, if the patient is having persistent difficulty to close the eyes, these are situations where you go for lateral torsography. So you may also try for chemo denervation with the botulinum toxin, and there are selective surgical procedures by which you can re-implant the nerve and the muscle such a way that the facial appearance can be improved. This is done with the help of plastic surgeons. So this is all applicable in that small group of 10 to 15% who will not show adequate
response.
How do you differentiate herpes simplex from Bell's palsy? There is no way. There is no way. That's how you are giving them acyclovir. Can you name the other viruses producing facial palsy? Herpes simplex,
varicella.
That's right. Cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, and retrovirus. And very common, mumps. Mumps can also produce sometimes facial palsy. Can you tell me something about Melkert's and Rosenthal syndrome?
It is syndrome associated with facial nerve palsy. It is a triad of infranuclear facial palsy and facial edema.
And they will have fissured tongue. And this edema is coming episodically. So today's class is basically telling us about a short case, simple facial paralysis. Our job is to differentiate UMN versus LMN. If it's LMN, it's in the pons, outside the pons, the CP angle, inside the bone, whether it is before the ganglion, in the ganglion, before the branch to stapedius, before the branch to caudate tympani, and then at the exit stylomaxillary foramen or in the parotid gland. And rarely you may get only one muscle is affected, like in a branch paralysis. Branch paralysis commonly occur when you have got an injury to face or surgery where one particular branch is affected. So that particular branch only produces signs, whole nerve may not be affected. Also it can occur in leprosy patients where only one branch is affected and there is a vasculitis. Otherwise, whole nerve is expected to be affected. One important problem is regarding bilateral UMN versus bilateral LMN, where it may be difficult to differentiate. Always concentrate on Jojerk and Bell's phenomenon. You will find easily you can differentiate between the two. In both conditions, phase will be symmetrical. There will not be asymmetry because both sides are paralyzed. So that's why the confusion comes. So go for associated signs as upgoing plantar, exaggerated Jojerk, you will get the diagnosis. The very simple, straightforward case. There's no confusion about it, but proper examination is a must, and we must always target to the etiology. Is there a scar on the face? Is the parotid enlarged? Is the scar or the mastoid? Is there pus discharge from the ear? Are there any features of Lyme disease, Hansen's disease, rotavirus infection, history of diabetes, any vesicles seem to be around? Specifically look for it. Number two, you look for the associations. Is it sixth nerve, fifth nerve, eighth nerve, or pyramidal lesions? You can localize. Then of course taste, hyperacusis, and the eye. So you can anatomically localize, and each anatomical area, the etiology is different. Peripheral branch is one etiology, parotid is one etiology, CP angle is another one, inside the mastoid is another one. So every area, the diagnosis, etiological diagnosis, different. Accordingly, management also differs. And LMN facial palsy may be the beginning of retrovirus infection. Commonly, Guillain-Barré starts in the lower limb and ascends up. Rarely only it comes down. So the ascending history of paralysis also will make you think there is a bilateral facial paralysis. So three causes for bilateral facial paralysis: LMN, commonly seen, diabetes, Guillain-Barré syndrome, sarcoidosis. I think it's a very simple case, brief case. If you got any doubt, you can ask.